Hello, folks. Here we are. Right. Okie dokie. Right. Before I get on with today's live stream, I want to give a big, massive shout out to this awesome YouTuber. Yeah. It's a female biker. She's an adventure rider. And her name is Rosie Gabrielle. Yeah. Rosie Gabrielle. And I'll be putting a link to her YouTube channel down in the first pinned comment of this video once the stream is finished, and I'll also put a link in the description. Rosie Gabrielle, I tell you, this girl is absolutely amazing. Yeah. She's done solo rides across Oman and also South Africa, and I'm telling you, she's got a little bit of a craziness about her. Yeah. But I think you need a bit of craziness about you to go out and do what she did. She's done these rides totally solo. You'll see all the ups and downs and everything of her travels. She's definitely worth going to check out. So as I said, that's Rosie Gabrielle, and I'll be adding links to her YouTube channel, as I say, in the first pinned comment of this stream, once the stream ends, and also in the description of the video. Now, let's see who we've got in here. Good evening, Kevin and Slim Shady Ironhead. Good evening. Oh, right. Fire Wolf Biker. Ooh, welcome back, Geezer. I owe you an actual email. I will get round to that email, Geezer, because what you did absolutely blew my mind, my friend. Right, it's all going a little bit crazy here. I don't want to forget anybody. Crikey, Romania, Campetti. Right, okay. Well, I will try and get round to you all. Right, and as I say, go and check out that fantastic YouTuber once this stream is finished. Right, so got your mug and T-shirt. You only die once. Good on you, fella. I'm glad you got it. Over on my Dibber 39, I'll be giving that company a massive shout out because they helped a good friend of mine out over there as well. Thank you very much, Ant. I have been watching your videos and such like, but I've been so busy this end here trying to get things sorted. As you can well imagine, it's been absolute madness. It's been spanner thrown in the works after spanner thrown in the works all the way through. It's been absolutely madness going on here. And yes, and those who have sent me messages asking about my poor ribs, yeah, they're starting to feel a little bit better now. I managed to get out on the old bike and go for a hoon. Hurt a little bit during the day, but yeah, once the old darkness came down and everybody had gone home, you know, from work and everything, I went out and had another good blast. It was absolutely fucking brilliant. Thank you very much, Dan. Yes, I tell you, I'm feeling much better today. I was actually getting onto the old winter painkillers and stuff, you know, because there was a change in the weather, but it's been pretty good here, so I haven't had to take them today, so I'm not quite so messed up in the head this week. I hope that doesn't ruin the stream. Let's see what we got here. Ken Sterling, good evening, chat. How you doing? I can't pronounce your name. Crikey. let's see if I can do something about making this screen a little bit bigger so I can see what everyone's saying. Right. Makes a change you watching me live. Yes, Slim Shady, it does. I've actually managed to get this system to work now. Paul Wilson. Hello, Dibs. Full part of a local club. Hope you're doing well and being an hour to watch your... Oh, excellent. Yes. Local level clubs. Excellent. Right. What have we got here? Oh, dear. Look, if you're going to start fucking insulting people in here, you see, you're going to get your ass thrown out. All right. So don't start that shit in here, all right? I'm going to put you on timeout because I don't allow that kind of behavior in my streams, all right? I don't care if you're insulting friends or whatever. You don't do it in my streams, all right? Log zipper, Sons of Anarchy, killed my ex-girlfriend, still got some ass. That was last week's stream. I'm going to be throwing up the invitation to pick this week's. It's not going to have anything to do with Sons of Anarchy, okay? We've already done that, okay? It's getting a little tad boring now. Oh, my. Who was that that just did that? I must. Let me just move forward. I've got to see who just did that. Ah, Camp Bell. Thank you very much. Much appreciated. That'll go straight to the old stash. I'm actually hoping to head out to Ireland very quickly. I've got some family business to take care of over in Ireland from when my brother passed away. I've still got a bit of family business to take care of out there. So I might actually be nipping out to Ireland in October. I've got some friends out there I want to go and see as well, yeah? Hi there, Philip Eastman. Yes, I know. This mortar thing has been a headache after a headache after a headache, yeah? But, you know, it's one of those things, you know? You can only reap the benefits of summer if you're willing to put in the time and energy. It's the same as if you're, you know, going to go and join a motorbike club or a motorcycle club or a, you know, a riding club. You've got to put in the time and effort. But it has been a real, real nightmare. I have to say, it has been absolutely freaking driving me nuts. Log Zipper, let's have a look what you're saying. You're going to start making excuses about being hacked, are you now? Your old account got hacked. Okay, Log Zipper. I'm gonna give you the benefit of the doubt. I'm gonna give you the benefit of the doubt, okay? Hi there, Mr. Kev. How you doing? Right, any chance of a list of all your educational videos in date order, please, Dibs? Well, they're all in date order as I uploaded them. Okay. If you just go to the main page of my YouTube channel, press videos, they are all there in the order in which I uploaded them. Yeah, thanks very much, Ross. It's proving to be a bit of a nightmare. They've got, I tell you what, I've never seen so much red tape in all my life. Right, notifications for both your accounts. Oh yeah, cheers for that, Alan Star. You're a star. Yeah, mine's messed up your mojo. Do you know what I watched? One episode of mine, just one, yeah. I just obviously you got to, if you, you know, curiosity and all the rest of it. And I have to say, 10 minutes in, I was ready to put my fingers down my throat. It's just not my thing. It really isn't. I'm all right. Thank you very much, Adam's Life on Two Wheels. What else are you saying? Yeah, well, it is actually a battle. It's a real battle, I tell you. You know, I just wish I could show you all just how much red tape there is involved in this. It is just mind-bending. I've never seen anything like it in my life. And I'm drinking water, by the way. I've done enough alcohol. The old ribs still haven't recovered yet from the last flipping session. That's what happens when you go out with Jester's Lab, mate. Yes, absolutely agree with you there, Ross Cannon. Absolutely. Stick with the old movies and stuff. They didn't sell out and start selling fucking T-shirts and stuff for it. What isn't no fun, Ironhead? No fun. Robo Iron Ink, while you're here, mate, you know the links that you sent me over on my other page, yeah, to some of your artwork. I've kept those links hidden, and I've kept them hidden for a reason, yeah. And that's basically to try and stop these fuckwit t-shirt companies from stealing your designs. I know you're already having trouble with that, so yeah, I'm going to keep those under wraps a bit. But once you get your website and everything up and running, mate. Because of all the support and everything you've given me here and over there, you send the link to me over there, and I'll put that on my website for you, mate, because, you know, the level of support you've been showing is mind-bending, mate. This has made your Sunday night. Thank you, Dude Monkfish. Tomorrow, roll on spring, keep up the positive vibes. Yeah. Roll on the spring. How many months have we got for that for now? What have we got? October, November, December, January, February, March, April. The weather starts getting good in May. So, yeah, it's like 8 months. But obviously, any days when I can get out riding, I'll get out riding. My mates have started calling me the walking barometer now. They always know what the weather's going to be doing literally you know, as the bones feeling day dibs, I think it's going to rain. And yeah, it rains. So yeah, I've become a bit of a walking barometer lately. what's this? Ants, squiggly, dibs. Would electrolyte enhance water? No, I just drink filtered water. I just put it through a filter and I just drink filtered water. I don't go in for all that malarkey. Do you know what I mean? Filtered water's enough. I just filter it, stick it in my bottle, and away you go. And I drink lots of it too because of the medications, kidneys and whatever. So you have to keep flushing yourself through to make sure you don't get stones and whatever in your kidneys. Hi there, Backstreet Zero. Love the videos. Keep it up, bud. I always try to. What we got here? Dean Aston. Ah, how you doing there? Dean, bit of WD-40 on the joints, bruv. Yes. I'm hoping to get back over to Israel in the new year to see you guys. Obviously, I couldn't make it over there this year. Other things came along and other plans and things changed. But, yeah, I hope to be back there quite early. If I'm actually in Malta, it's 2.5 hours away. So it's just like a local trip to come and visit you guys, okay? So you might be seeing more of me more often. More pity you guys. Well, I can't wait to... It's YouTube content is all good. Good evening, Guy C. No, you're not on instant ignore. It's just that the chat's running so fast this evening. I'm having a job catching up with everybody. Wolf, fire wolf biter, ever considered going to the USA? Well, I tell you what, right? I don't really want to go to the USA. I mean, my sister's an American citizen, yeah? She's got a green card and all the rest of it, yeah? She owns a trucking company over there with her husband, but... You know, all your fucking TSA and all that bollocks. Fuck that. I ain't got the patience for that stuff. I'd end up lashing out at people. No way am I, would I allow somebody to manhandle me that way. Not a chance. What bands do I like? And that comes from Alan Starr. I like everything, mate. I listen to classical music. One of my favourite bands is a band called the Enid. They do like... classic rock, classical rock with classical music, mix of rock music. I like punk music, but my biggest passion, I have to admit, my biggest passion is ska music, reggae music, blue beat, ragga and all that type of stuff. That's the sort of music I like listening to. Short handlebars or tall. If they're out here, they're comfortable. All this arms up in the air malarkey, I can't be doing with that. I like to just be able to reach out straight in front of me and my bars are there. I don't, you know, I can't ride a bike with low bars anymore, which is why I don't own a VFR anymore. I got a cruiser now. My bars, as you've seen in one of my videos, my arms just out nice and straight. That's really comfortable for me now. Right. Ryan Sattel, any plans? To have a party or anything before I go to Malta? Well, it's a bit awkward, a bit difficult, really, because obviously some people don't mix, if you know what I mean. So it'd be very difficult. It'd have to be something that's private, organised, and I really don't want to do that, you know what I mean? Because obviously I'd have to leave people out, you know, that maybe would want to come because somebody else would be coming. And it gets a little bit awkward, you know, so it's all that politics of it all. So it's, yeah. So probably not. I'll probably throw a big party on a live stream. Come on in, get absolutely freaking hammered with you all and do something that way. Keep it all nice and neutral. I would really like to do something like that, you know, Ryan. But as I say, it's the politics of it all because I've got a lot of friends in lots of different clubs. And they're all around the country. And as you well know yourself that, you know, some things don't mix. Yes, for fuck's sake. Yes, Guy. Madness and the Specials. Well, I went and saw the Specials up in Coventry before they were even called the Specials, when they were still called the Coventry Automatics. That was going back some. That's before Terry Hall ever joined the band, that was. So, yeah, that's going back a bit. I was doing the two-tone thing before two-tone ever become popular. Good evening, Vidvid from Scotland. Good to see you. Ah, there you go. How you doing there, Anglo-Saxon? I might have to slow this stream down because it's running a little bit fast here at the minute. Glass of wine in hand. Ah, yes, I'm partial to a bit of wine. I like white wines, actually. There's one I like in particular. It comes from Italy. I like the old Pinot Grigio. That's what I like. Got into that when I owned my pub. Half a pint of Pinot in a glass. Half a pint of lemonade on top. Lovely jubbly. Half a dozen of those and you know you've had a drink. Mate went on, what's this, Rat Boy, mate went on holiday to Malta. He was telling me all about all the really old motors over there. Yeah, they have. They've got some really, really old motors over there. Because, and again, it goes back to what I was talking about in another one of my streams. They get fucking seriously hammered over there with registration fees. I mean, it's just absolutely mental. So even the companies that sell cars, yeah, you know, the car dealerships, you know, they get hammered with it really bad, and then they have to pass that expense on to the customer. So cars over there are really, really expensive. So you'll see a lot of old cars over there, man, and buses too. Really old buses, the really old buses that they were using in the 50s and stuff. They're really cool. And I like all that kind of stuff, you know. It kind of takes you back a bit when you're seeing cars driving around on the streets that you saw driving around in the UK, like in 1980, you know, and they're the kind of cars that have all gone through the scrapyard now, you know. Oh, dear. Right. If you put swear words in the stream, I have to keep going to it and allowing it. So kindly, if you, you know, kind of abbreviate them if you can. MG Tau, have I heard about it? Yeah, right. But what else we got here? Long time stalker, first time chatter. Love watching your videos and the info. Thanks a lot for your time. That's from OSF or Oddball. Right, I'm going to have to do something about this screen because it's very difficult seeing who's doing what. What's for tea? Do you have a moving in date yet? Absolutely not, yeah. No. As I say, I'm still jumping through all the hoops of the red tape. And a plan. Let's put it this way. I had a plan of mine come to fruition 2 weeks ago. Yeah, I'd be in Malta now. But the vehicle I wanted to take with me, the camper, they wanted to sting me €2,300 to register it in Malta. Because I won't be staying there temporary. I'll be staying permanent, which means applying for residency. And the moment you apply for residency, you're no longer considered a visitor. And then once that happens, you have to register your vehicle. Normally you'd be able to drive it around for a little while, but with Brexit just around the corner, I have to make sure that I'm secure there, yeah? Especially if I'm going to be buying a piece of land when my pot comes up to be cashed in April. Project Redford, my Honda has these big goofy junkyard bars. Oh, crikey, let's roll this back. Oh, yeah. Short ones like a calf racer or just keep the bobber style. You know, how you do your bike is up to you, man. It's whatever's comfortable, yeah? But it's not only has to be comfortable, yeah, it's got to be practical and you've got to be able to, it's got to keep safe. The bike's got to be safe. You know, I see people doing lots of stuff to their bikes, man. I think to myself, you know, I wouldn't want to be in certain situations with some of the setups they have, especially with those fucking great eye bars. When I had my near fatal accident in the mid 80s, I tell you, I had high bars on that, chop bars, and you would not believe the damage that did to my hips and everything. I tell you, my legs really fucked me up, I'm telling you. So I like to have if I'm going to go over the front, I like it. I don't like any obstructions in the way, like Sherpa vans and shit like that, or great big handlebars. And Star, love your cider. Yeah, well, my dad comes from Somerset, that side of the family. You know, so Somerset, real cider and all that, you know, the old steel cider. I love that stuff, man. We used to sit down and drink that when we were kids at the dinner table. Blinding stuff. Romania dual sport. What is the subject tonight? Wow, you guys are the subject, you know. You throw the stuff out there and I just answer the questions, or we just take the piss, you know. We just shoot the wind. I don't actually pick a particular topic for the live streams. They're just to come on here and just have a yabber with you guys. When I pick a particular subject, I'll actually make a video about it, yeah. And I just try to keep those as short, as sweet as possible. Well, not always sweet, but I just like to try and keep those as short as possible. But no, tonight is just the crazy shit where you guys come in and start throwing questions. Yeah. I bought a nice model of a Malta bus for €4. Yeah. You never pick up a bus in Malta for €4. Everything cost 100 times more over there. Just subscribe today. This is Corey. Bloody hell. Corey Mink, just subscribed today. Looking forward to watching more of your videos. Thank you very much. Function over fashion with motorcycles. Absolutely correct there, Firewolf. Absolutely correct. Project Redfoot. Redfoot, high bars are comfy, but turns are a pain in the ass. Absolutely. That's one of the things I used to hate, because I used to have a 754 Super Sport Honda. Had bars up here on it, you know, and, you know, it's sometimes just not practical, you know, just not practical. What's that iron head? Epic video, Black Dragon, Dibber and James from Insane Throttle. How's that sound, Dibber? I don't do those types of videos, I'm afraid. They do their thing, I do mine. We live in different worlds. Yeah, I suppose it could be a good laugh for a live stream if we're all in the same room. No doubt there'd be some pretty good debates going on. And but yeah, I don't know. I'm pretty funny about all that stuff, yeah. You've seen guys with normal bars end up with shattered pelvis. Yeah, so have I, mate. And some of the old sports bikes as well, if you remember. You know, with the seat sat right down low and the tank that came up and it was quite flat. I've seen guys split their pelvises that way as well. Yeah, not a nice thing, I'll tell you. I fractured my pelvis many moons ago. Really fucking painful. It's a really painful injury. Ba-da-ba-dum. Somerset Wellington is where your folks are from, and that's from Westers. Yeah, mine are all down to all Shepperton Mallet way. Malta sounds like a place I should go. Love all the classic cars, buses, etc. I'm not a 21st century person. I'm told I'm an old fart. Yeah, so am I, Rob. I'm an old fart, mate. I prefer a lot of the old stuff. But I do like the reliability of a lot of the new stuff too. You know? what else we got here? Old Harley or Honda Magna? No, I wouldn't touch one of those Magnas. Nah, they couldn't take my riding. That's why I opted out for a VFR, you know, gear-driven cams and all that, bulletproof engine. You can rag the shit out of them all day. what's my advice on bars who have top and bottom rockers on their t-shirts? Well, like I said, I don't like any of that stuff that imitates the back patch of an MC. It's plain and simple. I mean, I can't make it any simpler than that, Alan. You know, it's a design that everyone's jumping on now, and it just pisses me off when I see everyone just putting it on just because it looks cool, you know, or they want to attract business by, you know, using that design and all that stuff. Fuck it. No. I mean, it's all right if motorcycle organizations and all that are using a, you know, a design that's got that kind of, you know, ribbons and whatever, you're all in that sort of thing. But that's motorcycle related. But when these companies, you know, that are just throwing up fucking designs that have got a top rocker and a bottom rocker and then a company logo in the middle, as far as I'm concerned, they can all go and get fucked. You know what I mean? As simple as that. I don't like it. Plain and simple. I can't make it any more simpler than that. When you move to Malta, what kind of health system do they have there? Is it free or do you have to buy a plan? Well, I mean, let's put it this way. If you want to go and see a doctor, it costs you 10 euros. Okay. But I think there's, I think the UK and Malta, they've got a special relationship. They've already said it. The special relationship will still continue after we leave. So we'll have to see. I mean, they've got a normal, you know, health system, the same as what we have. But if you want to go and see a GP, you're looking at 10 euros to go and see a GP. Evening all. Dibs, is there a certain age an MC, MCC would consider you too old to hang around prospect? Well, I know guys that are in their 50s that are going through prospecting right now. So I hope that answers your question. With an MCC, it's a bit easier with them guys. But like I say, I know a couple of guys at the moment I've been chatting to. They're in their mid-50s. They're prospecting for MCs. So it's, I mean, if you can, you know, if you're up on your feet and you can handle the life and everything that goes with it, I can't see why there's any reason why you shouldn't be able to. But it is, you know, you're looking at 100% dedication. You know, you've got compulsory runs that you go on and all the rest of it. You're going to need to be able to start with all that stuff if you want to go down that road. Old Triumph as those tank-mounted luggage racks, i.e. the bollock remover from the Hool. Yeah, they have. Yeah, I know. Yeah, the chrome thing on the tank. Yeah, to put the bag on. Oh, yeah, I remember those things. Fucking hell, yeah. Yes, definitely testicle removers. Right, what we got here in Florida, where are we? Here in Florida, your arms can't be above shoulder height, so eight bars are regulated. Well, that's a bloody good idea, do you know what I mean? Absolutely. What was my first bike, Dibs? Which do you miss the most? Well, that would depend on going out riding a pit bike or actually on the road. Now, the pit bike that we used to hoon around on as kids, me and my brother and a few mates, was an old Honda C70, yeah, with everything all hacked out of it that could be hacked out of it so that we could touch the ground. So that big fat seat that was on it, off with that, do you know what I mean? And it was just a pad. So but that was the pit bike. But my first bike on the road was an RD250 air-cooled. And I was... as I said in last week, so I didn't have any docks or anything back in them days. And which bike do I miss the most? I miss my VFR. I miss the VFR for its 100% reliability and its bulletproof engine. Just can't ride one anymore because the bones don't allow it. The guy called Art. Do I like Diners or FX? I'm not a Harley man, mate. I'm not a Harley man in the slightest. Got no interest in them. Too expensive for the spares. Not reliable enough for my liking. And especially from what I've been watching from Chuck's videos with all the fucking plastic bits inside the engine all wearing out and using aluminium against steel and all that. And, you know, fuck that. Give me a Honda. Do you know what I mean? Give me a Honda or give me a good Suzuki any day of the week. But then you see, over here, we haven't got that loyalty like they've got in the United States to the Harley Davidson. I mean, I've got a lot of mates that own Harley Davidsons. I just wouldn't want one. What's my thoughts on a person riding a bike too small for them, tall and heavy on a sportster versus short and light person? I mean, you know, if you're riding a small bike and you're a fucking hoofing great monster, you're a fool. You're a fool. It's that simple. You know, you get a bike to fit you. Yeah. Gotta love Div for an honest opinion. I'll give you a freaking honest opinion. I don't beat around the bush for nobody. I say it like I see it. COSOC, good evening. Dinner? Flipping hell. I can understand that. It's right next to the B, isn't it? I get that a lot. Thinking of triking the bike. Never ridden one. Any experience of what type of ride? Appreciate your thoughts. I don't own any trikes. I've never ridden any trikes. I've got a couple of friends that are well into their trikes, but I would go on the forums myself and seek advice on that, because I can't give advice on something I don't ride or never ridden. Robo Iron Link. Am I in favour of rocking chairs? They have bottom rockers. That's probably the only ones I am interested in. Nothing like sitting outside in a nice rocking chair, you know, with a big old glass bubbly on the go, man. Watching the stars, lovely jubbly. What we got here? Let me just scroll back up here. Oh, I had a C90, great fun. Yeah, they're great fun, man. I'll tell you what they did over here. I don't know if any of you guys saw it on YouTube. The old Honda, I'm not sure whether it was a C70 or a C90 that they did it with. There was the guy that got one, and he was going to see just how bulletproof they really are. So he went out with one, and he fucking ragged the shit out of it in first gear, trying to kill the engine. Couldn't kill the bike. He's just ragging the fuck out of it everywhere. Next thing he did was he went to he drained the oil out of it, went to a local chip shop, got a load of the vegetable oil, which had had chips and shit cooked in it, put that in the engine, did the same thing, ragging the fuck out of it for miles and miles, trying to kill the engine. He couldn't kill it, yeah? So in the end, he took the fucking nut, something out the bottom, he drained the oil out of it, and he ragged the absolute fuck out of it again. He still couldn't kill it. So in the end, they took it up onto a high building, and they threw it off of a high building. He went down, put the key in the ignition, what was left of the bike, turned the key, hit the kickstart, and the engine started again. You just can't kill them. They're bulletproof, man. what was this one? Project Redfoot. My Honda is a C7 postie bike frame. Had it all chopped up. Do you know what? I've seen some really good ones of those at the old bike shows. I've seen a few of the lads with scooters too, you know, the old Lambrettas and all that stuff, and Vespas, all chopped up with their beautiful paintwork on it. I might have to put some pictures out. I've actually got a whole load of photography because I like to do motorcycle photography. So what I might do is I might actually put a video up of some of the photography I did, taking pictures of all the old customized scooters and what have you. Some of that stuff is really, you know, that some of that stuff is pretty hardcore. Some of those scooter boys are pretty freaking hardcore too. Harleys be expensive in Europe. Harleys are expensive anywhere you go. Probably except for America. I know they're really, really expensive. If you want a Harley somewhere like in Malta, flipping registration fees for one of those is off the scale, man. You could probably buy a Harley back home for what it cost you just for registration fees. A 115cc engine on a 1966 C70 frame. You're braver than I am. You're definitely braver than what I am. Suzuki Street Fighter. Bandits are really good for turning into Street Fighters. Got a few mates that have got the old Bandit Street Fighters. They're pretty fucking smart, I tell you. Let's have a little scroll down here. Oh, I like that. Yeah, you're dead right there, Westers. Harley's yesterday's technology at tomorrow's prices. Never a truer word spoken. Dean Aston, I'm 6'6" on a Honda Rebel. Yeah, well, you're just a bloody nutcase anyway, Dean. But no, I mean, that's not too bad for you, actually, a Honda Rebel. Not so long as it's not a 125 one. If you're on a 125 one, you're definitely a braver man than me, I'm telling you. What's that? I opt out of the 125cc bollocks back in the day. Was too tall for. Oh, right. Okay. Yeah, right. Do they still make Nortons and BSAs? No. No. I mean, a few attempts have been made to reintroduce the Norton. I mean, we had the Norton with the Wangle engine going back a fair few years ago. But the only one that's really, truly, truly made a good comeback is Triumph. And the Royal Enfields are not even made here anymore. They're made in India. So, but the only one that's really, truly made any impact is Triumph. Da-da-da-da. So you've never lived until you've seen a chopped scooter. Long ass forks, yeah. Swedish chopped scooters. I tell you, I've seen them. There's some really hardcore ones out there. What brand do I use? I use Canon, mate. And I've got a host of different cameras. I'm not going to sit here listing them all off. Don't want someone knocking me over the freaking head when I'm coming out of an airport somewhere. But yeah, I've got a nice collection of cameras, all different ones for different things. Usually when I go to a rally, I usually take a decent camera with me. But I don't use mine are all digital cameras now. Harley in Europe get nicked in no time. Well, if you park one in London. Yes, he has got stones. Absolutely. Oh, Jake Ford. What a fucking lovely comment. Okay. Not a problem. Not a problem. Bye bye. There's always one, isn't there? Always one has to come in and start trouble and try and spoil things. Oh, AWOL magazine. The Hall, that was a good magazine. I used to be a Backstreet Heroes fan. I used to buy Backstreet Heroes to basically for there used to be a guy in one of the motorcycle clubs over here. And he used to write up in the Backstreet Heroes, and I used to buy Backstreet Heroes literally for his, and his name was Maz Harris. Superb writer. So if you get access to any old copies of Backstreet Heroes, go and look up the writings of Maz Harris. Superb, mate. And I used to buy it literally just for that. The guy called Art. What are your thoughts on rigid frame jap chops like with GSXR engines? I've seen some really good ones, actually. I think they're really cool what they do with them. Wouldn't ride one myself unless it's got a decent sprung saddle. I actually like to have a spine that's still intact. Well, relatively still intact. You know what I mean? But no, it's rigid. I can't do rigid. I had a spinal injury in the mid-80s. Also in my neck as well, so I can't ride a rigid. Has to have suspension. As they say, hardly ever go. Hash mopeds. I'm looking forward to seeing the new RE650 twin. Taking an age to hit the shops in the UK, though. Vid. I'll have to go and look that one up. I don't actually follow all that type of stuff. I mean, I just get on the bike and I just go out and ride. I don't spend time looking through, manufacturers' websites and, spending time wandering around it, these shows that they put on with all the new models and shit. I'd rather just be out on my bike. Than do all that stuff. So I don't wish to sound sort of like a twat or anything, but it's just not my thing. I'd rather be riding than looking. You Thea, hey, well, you got a letter published in AWOL once. They thought I was a nutter. Well, I am, so I can't blame them. Jinx, well, see, my bedroom was covered in Backstreet Hero centerfolds. They used to have some lovely centerfolds, didn't they? In the old Backstreet Heroes, man. Fucking lovely. Alan Starr, what tattoos do I have? I've got a couple. I got one up here. I got a big paradise bird up here, which I had done when I was 17, which really needs a cover up now. I got my Coptic stuff from the army. I've got a scar tattoo on here from when I was a rude boy. So I've got a couple tattoos, but I don't really sort of show them off. Dan Downey, you had the privilege of meeting Maz in the early 90s. Legend. He was total legend, man. Absolute total legend. One of the most ingenious writers and creative writers. You know, I could sit and read his stuff for days on end. Absolutely superb. I'll put some links to his books down in the description as well, because he wrote a couple of books. He's got a PhD. He had a PhD in it as well. So... What made me start my YouTube channel? I used to be on Google Videos years and years ago. I used to do political videos over on Google Videos. And then when YouTube came along and Google bought up YouTube, what they did, they married the two together. So I automatically was switched across to YouTube. So I continued doing all the political stuff that I used to do. I don't know. You kind of get into start doing it, and then what I did was I started to do fucked up news stories. Yeah, I used to put my own twist on some really fucked up news stories, and it kind of took off. And you know, once you start becoming a content creator, anyone that's become a content creator, once the bug bites, that's it. The bug bites. You know. And, you know, and the rest is history. I'm here now making videos on this channel as well. So, yeah. I've actually, on my Dibber 39, I've just actually started to upload some of the old content that I used to do back in the early days of YouTube. It seems to be going down quite well, too. I'll put one up there this week. Where Are They Now? Which is an expose on what happened to Sooty Sweep and Sue, which is quite comical. I know a few people enjoyed that one. let's just scroll back here. Fire Wolf, don't do politics anymore. Just can't do it. Too many pretenders and liars in the political realm. Absolutely, mate. Couldn't agree with you more. But I was as critical doing the politics stuff as I am of doing anything, yeah? Anything I feel passionately about, I can be very critical, yeah? Okay, Robbo, Iron Ink, you stay safe, mate, and you take care, mate. I'll catch you another day, another way, yeah? And don't forget, mate, to get that that link to me once you get that site up and running, mate. AWOL, everything flat, black, Street Fighters equals don't cover anything. Yeah, it did actually kind of get that way a little while. Do I ride all year round? And that comes from Patang. I ride as much as I can now, because obviously I've got a really dodgy bone disease, and it can prevent me from riding in particular weather. So, and I have to take opiate-based painkillers. And if you get caught in the UK on opiate-based painkillers, any motor vehicle, whether it be a car or a bike, that's it. They treat it the same as drink driving. So if I'm in pain and I have to take painkillers, you will not see me on my bike. End of. But before this struck, I rode all year round. Rain, sleet, snow, all the rest. I had a winter bike and a summer bike. So, yeah, I used to ride all year round. Firewolf, philosophy and music is your focus now. Yeah, it's pretty much like I am, and motorcycles too. Let's go back. Have I ever been to the TT? Yeah, went many, many years ago with my dad when I was very, very young. I haven't been back since. I'd actually like to do it again, actually. But like I say, I'd rather be out riding than watching. But yeah, my dad took me out there many years ago, my brother. The Harrow Arrow. How long have I been off of the cigarettes? 4.5 years. 4.5 years. Gave them up 4.5 years ago. And to coin a phrase that my granddad used when he gave up smoking, I gave them up as a bad joke because I don't find the punchline very amusing. Dib, I could get my teeth into your... Oh, into my slant and what's going on. Yeah, well, don't worry. I'll be touching on a few subjects. Don't you worry about that. Mike Stark says, sends nudes, please. Yeah, you got about as much chance of that happening as me going over to the Vatican and fucking the Pope up the arse over the fuck. Over the altar, mate. Won't happen. What we got here? X Ninja 15. Yeah, you might as well speak in English. Those will stay under review until I can translate them. Yeah, people send spam, it gets blocked on my stream. Patang 31, what bike am I riding? I ride a VZ800 Suzuki. It's absolutely perfect for me, for what I need. Goes fast as I need it to go, and it's as smooth as I need it to be. Johnny Walker Red, watched your Sooty and Sweet video. You're a crazy man. You haven't met Bob Hardnut, the Dark Lord of the Underworld, yet, or Angry Sock Bert, or Dick Stroker. Yeah, the conspiracy theorist. That's another one to keep an eye out for. They'll all be coming in due course. Go to the TT and get Harry Cake. Wouldn't know what that is. Come on, Mike Stark. Stop that. Yeah, send the nudes, please. Silly man. Guy C. I don't know if you know, but the call on the meds and the license deal is dependent on the doctor report. No, it's not. Not in the United Kingdom, it isn't. If it's opiate-based, you can lose your license for it. I've looked really deep into all this stuff. And they also put out a notification some time back about it. If you're on opiate-based painkillers, the same as what I am, if they make you drowsy or anything like that, mate, you're not allowed to fucking drive on them. End of. Something I've looked into at great length. I used to work for an accident management company, so for motor vehicles, so I'll make sure I stay on top of all this stuff. What's my thoughts on the whole thing of bringing in electric bikes? That's from Sean O'Sullivan. I did a video about it, actually, about Harley-Davidson's electric bikes. You know, the thing of it is, I've got no problem with them, so long as the longevity's there. Yeah, and it's not going to cost you shitloads of money to charge them up. But the downside of it is, and the gripe that I'm going to have with them, is the fact that they're so quiet. Yeah, they're like silent. And in that respect, it makes them dangerous, not just on the road, you know, for other road users, you know, but also for pedestrians, because they can't hear you coming. Do you know what I mean? So there would have to be some sort of way of creating a noise that can create, you know, so that people know you're coming. Mike Stark, thanks, love. You are the best. No, I'm not. There's better than me out there. I just come on here and just say shit as I see it. Let's have another little scroll down. Alan R. Hey, guy, how you goes? How's that calf going? All right, he's talking to somebody else. Project Redford taking the old bars off as we speak. putting dirt bike bars on it. Yeah, stick a nice pair of Renfalls on it, man. Yeah, a nice pair of Renfalls. They do the job. Maybe a little bit for the next live stream, yeah. My buddy working on a pan head, that's from Alan R. Good for him. Good for him. I always like to hear people working on their own bikes rather than taking them in the shop. I always used to do all my own spanner work on my own too. I still do, actually. It's like a religion for me now. I get out the toolbox and I start at the front and I go all the way from front to back. Go to the other side, front to back, and then I repeat myself and back to front, make sure I haven't missed anything. I just go around making sure all the bolts are all torqued up to the right settings and everything. You can never be too careful. I think everybody should do it, actually. It's a good way of learning your way around your bike. No, Guy, not over here, mate. It's not to do with cognitive tests over here. If you take any medications that can cause drowsiness or sleepiness or cause you to be having a fuzzy head, which is what happens to me if I take the opiate-based meds, then you're not allowed to drive. You're not allowed to ride a motorcycle. And if you get caught, you're up shit creek without a paddle, mate. They treat it exactly the same as drink driving. And if you want to know how fucked up I get on my painkillers, yeah, just ask Tony from Jester's Lab. Because obviously when I took my fall and fucking smashed my ribs out there, I took a couple to try and calm that down. And he'll tell you how fucked up I get on those things. There's no way could I ride or drive while on those, man. Not a chance. What have we got down here? And Squirrely, just my luck, finally get to Antwerp and maybe one day to a trip to London and we'll be out of the country. That probably will be the case if I can get shit going. Like I say, the only thing that's holding me up at the minute is literally a few grand. And that's just literally for the registration for my vehicle. And I'll be gone, mate. As soon as I've got that, I'm fucking gone. So Co, have I heard anything about this new MC series called Riptide with Val Kilmer? No, I haven't. I'll go and have a look up though, because I think there's too much of this now. I think there's way too much. It's starting to really take the piss. What's my favorite takeaway? That comes from Alan Starr, and that is Indian. My favourite takeaway, well, I'm a vegetarian for starters, so I have to admit I am a real pizza fiend. I absolutely fucking love pizzas. I've got a real weakness for them, and Chinese. And if I'm going to have an Indian, it has to be a proper traditional. None of that shit that's served up in the takeaway in this country. I got a place real local to me, yeah. It's around the back of a little local shop. And I pop round the back there and he knows my face and I say, you make it proper, the old traditional. And it always comes to me the old proper traditional way, you know, with the proper samosas and all that sort of stuff. Not the sort of coloured crap that you get from a takeaway man. You know, I don't eat none of that garbage. Let's try and get down here a little bit. Sean O'Sullivan, completely agree with you. Loud pipe save lives. I think I heard that Harley was thinking of putting speakers on the electric bikes to emanate the sound of their petrol bikes. Well, it would actually need something like that, yeah. But as I said, I worked in accident management for 2.5 years. I read report after report that actually it's 50-50. Whether loud pipes save lives. It just depends what situation you are in, okay? Because the sound when you're traveling along, yeah, the sound from the exhaust pipes, if you've got a car in front of you, yeah, the chances are they will not hear you until you're right on top of them. Yeah. So in that respect, loud pipes don't save lives. They can save lives of pedestrians stepping out in front of you and all that sort of stuff. So in that respect, they can save lives. But as I say, I've read report after report after report, and they've done different experiments, and it's around 50-50 whether or not they do. Yeah, there's no absolute defined saying yes, having loud pipes will save your life in no matter whatever situation you're in, because it's simply not true. It's a punchline type thing, you know. It sells patches to stick on your waistcoat. You'll never see a loud pipe save lives on my waistcoat, I can tell you that. Patang 31, I work on both my bikes, saves a lot of cash and more for bikes. Yeah, well, this is the thing, you see, and the thing of it is, if you work on your own bike, any fuck up is your own. Okay, any fuck up is your own. I know people that have put their bikes in for services or to have new brake shoes and shit put in. When they've got the bike back, they found something wrong with it. So I rather do it myself. And if something's going to be fucked up, I'd rather fuck it up myself than have somebody else do it. You know, I don't like other people working on my bikes. There's a couple of people, only a couple of people I would ever trust to work on a bike of mine. I can tell you that. And that's because they're as anal about all the going from front to back, from back to front and everything else as I am, going over it, double checking it, triple checking it, and quadruple checking it. Just go all the way around. You can never check it too many times. Project Redford, more like baseball cards in the flywheel. Do you remember that when we were kids? Yeah, I don't know how many more any of you did that. You get the playing cards, yeah, and you put them around the bar with the old fucking, you're nicking your mum's pegs for the washing, and you have the old playing cards going in the back spokes, and the back wheel goes around. God knows how many sets of playing cards I went through doing that. Triumph make a reliable bike now. Yes, they do. Absolutely do. Do you know what? I've got a lot of mates that ride the old Triumphs, and they absolutely swear by them. So, Co, my mum loves you. More for your mum. You kind of got into calling out the fake patch wearing guys. Well, yeah, why the fuck not? I mean, you know, it really pisses me off. Do you know what I mean? I know guys that have gone through hell to get their fucking patches. Do you know what I mean? And it's a total insult to what those guys have gone through. It really fucking is. I know guys that have shed blood for their fucking patches. Do you know what I mean? And then you get some fucking fuckwit walking around wearing something that they shouldn't be wearing. You know, something that I know people have put their lifeblood into. It really pisses me off when I see it. Do you know what I mean? To me, it's the same as, you know, ripping off somebody wearing a fucking uniform that served in the armed forces. That's how it is for me, and that's how it is for a lot of guys too, you know, because it takes a lot of fucking dedication and stuff to get a set of patches on your waistcoat, I can tell you that. If you join a proper traditional club, if you join a proper traditional MCC or a proper traditional MC, man, it takes shitloads of work to get those patches. It really does, and I think it really violates everything. You know, and all these fucking pop-up clubs as well, you know, where they can send $65 to get a set of fucking patches. I tell you, if anyone moses up to me wearing a set of those, there'll only be two words that come out of my mouth. And the first one will be fuck, and the second one will be off. Can't tolerate that shit. Paul Wilson, thanks to you, bud, I got into the club scene. And since then, I've been tough. Hang on, I've been tough by friend in an MTC, so I'm now building my custom, and the clubs have kept me going through hard times. Yes, they will, man, they will. If you find a good club and everything, you know, it becomes like part of your extended family, you know, it is like your extended family, man. And if you get into a good club and everything, you know, they'll help you, they'll always be there, and in fact they'll probably be there when other people won't be there, you know. there's one of these other old sayings, you find out who your true friends are when you join a motorcycle club. Most of those people that you thought were your friends before you put the patch on, yeah, you'll find that they drift away from you. But you just have a whole new group of people that come in that you can really depend on. And most of the time you really can depend on those guys. Although, you know, like I say, with all the pop-up clubs and all those sort of club, you can't depend on those guys. They'll turn and fucking run the first sign of trouble. Yes, the Alan R, the electric dirt bikes. I was actually watching some racing on YouTube the other day, which was electric dirt bikes. I tell you, the torque on those things is unbelievable. And the speed they were going was, wow, it looked pretty scary. Ant Squirrely, White Pizza. All right, what we got here? Anglo-Saxon, two people have lost their lives for their club. So with you on that one. Yeah, they have. People have lost their lives because of it, yeah? Right, hang on a minute. Let me just scroll back up here. Guy C, more fool your mum. Yeah, absolutely, mate. Yeah, I don't think your mum would want me around too long. What's this from Vidvid? Any progress? Including a biker-friendly car sticker in my range of merchandise. RE, checking your bike. I have to check mine for bits falling off. Well, I'll do some stickers over on my merchandise, but you can't do any of that stuff through this channel. Can only be done through my other channel, through my website. Grim Vander, internet viruses learning in the real world for the new guys. What are your thoughts? Oh, internet versus learning in the real world. Oh, depends who you're listening to on the internet, doesn't it? I usually try to give people the information that they need, but I'll always point them. If you want to learn and you want to learn at the ground level, go and fucking join a club, because it's the only way you're really going to learn. It's the only way you're really going to learn. All I can do is point you in the right direction. That's all I can do, yeah? And give you my opinion on certain situations, you know. But other than that, if you really want to truly find out what it's all about, go out and meet the clubs, go and prospect for a club and go out and do it. That's the only way to really know. And again, like I say, you can, it's like, you know, there's certain things that I find irritating, yeah, because you've got to take into consideration, yeah. Clubs are different all over the place. No two clubs are the same. No two clubs prospect people in the same, yeah. You know, so it's, you have to get down to club level and go and prospect for a club, and then you could go somewhere else and find that it's done totally differently, all right? So it's this is why I take an issue with certain stuff that I see on the internet. The only way to truly know is to go and join one, yeah? And then, as I say, they could be different in the next place. So that's how it is. Hell yeah, a buddy of mine prospected. He worked really hard for his patch. Total respect for Patch Brothers. It's the only way to be. It's the only way to be. You know what I mean? It's the only way to be. Alan R. Yes, they are fucking posers. It's pot noodle fame. Just add morons. Tony Sirrett, what's my thoughts on these little 50cc scooters? My daughter's just turned 16 and is after a proper leg over 50cc motorbike. I would advise her to go and get a 50cc motorbike. Little wheels, potholes, all that type of stuff against a larger wheel, pothole. You only have to think about the logistics of that, yeah? So, I would always advise a proper motorcycle over a scooter any day of the week. But if people want to ride scooters, they can ride scooters. But I wouldn't, never, if I had a child, yeah, who wanted to get into bikes, There's no way on this planet they'd be riding a fucking scooter, I could tell you that, simply because of the safety aspect of it. Hello from Scotland. How am I doing? Yeah, I'm doing pretty good. I'm doing pretty, pretty good. Alan R., anything fast and dangerous is always fun. Yes, I did actually see the footage of the MotoGP where that rider pulled the brake lever of the other rider's bike. My opinion on that is that guy has got a history of acting like a fuckwit on the track. Yeah, this isn't the first time he's done some fuckwittery on the track. And as far as I'm concerned, he should get a life ban for what he did. An absolute life ban. That could have been absolutely fatal. Not just for the other guy. It could have took him out as well. That could have caused a fatal accident. And, yeah, I think the guy should get a life ban for that. Let's have a little scroll down here. Grim Vander, your channel is one of the better ones. There was no internet when I started out. Great answer, by the way. Yeah, there was no internet, but, you know, we used to have some really good magazines, as you well know. AWOL, Backstreet Heroes was good for the UK. That could give you some good pointers, and especially, like I say, if you went and read up with people like, you know, Maz Harris and that, they always give you good advice. Yes, the good on the track. He needs to be fucked off. Absolutely needs to be fucked off for what he did. What we got down here? Banning for life. Attempted GBH. Should have been locked up. I mean, as far as I know, he's lost his contract for next season. And as far as I've been told, his backers have also dropped him as well. So he absolutely deserved that. Absolutely. Ross Cannon, I took your advice as I was too busy to commit to an MCC. Joined a riding club. Lots of great events without the commitment. Yeah, well, that's the path I'll always tell people to take, you know, because you have to bear in mind I'm pretty anal about MCC. It's where I started. And I'm just as protective over that as I am of the MC thing as well. I'm just as protective and I'm just as freaking anal over this whole MCC thing. And I'm going to be doing a video about that because since I put up that video the other day, my inbox on Facebook has it's gone insane. I've been contacted by different MCCs all over the country saying, please, dudes, please do this video. We're getting pretty shitty, sick and tired of a lot of the stuff that we're seeing. So, yeah, I'm definitely going to be doing that one because, you know, as I say, there's a fair few of them out there got pretty pissed off by what they're seeing going on. But you got certain groups of people, you know, that really should be calling themselves, you know, well, in fact, they should just be calling themselves social clubs. They have no proper structure. They don't know what the fucking officer's duties are, all this type of stuff. I get people come to me all the time in Messenger when they want to start up a club and they say, oh, you know, we want to do this. We want to call ourselves this type of MCC. And first thing I say to them is, what's the responsibilities of a sergeant at arms? And if they can't answer it, I just say, go out and be a social club until you've learnt this stuff, the basics. You know what I mean? Because unless you know what the basics are, you shouldn't be calling yourself an MCC because they have a proper structure. And I know some guys out there right across the country, different clubs, you know, people that I've rolled with, man, and they're fucking hardcore. They can be as hardcore as some of the MCs, I'm telling you. And I know a few. And I tell you what, I'll go as far as to say, I know a front patch, they wear it down here, big fucking front patch down here. It's a three-piece front patch with a side rocker MCC. Yeah, so it's you know, they're the kind of people that I, you know, there's MCCs that I know. And I personally, I'd like to see a clampdown on all these people that should be called social, that should be called social clubs, that are calling themselves MCCs, because it looks bad for the guys that really are doing it. But I'm going to get onto that in a video. I'm not going to get onto it in this live stream. even though I want to. What we got going on here? Anglo-Saxon 2, I have a question, Dibba. Been riding for years. Is an accident something that will happen? Not if, but when. Regardless of how safe you ride, in your experience, is that it? Yeah, it is. Absolutely. Absolutely. It's it can be. It's, you know, I mean, I know some people that have gone right the way through their riding careers, right up till now, and never had a knock. But for the majority, at some point, whether it's just you're fucking riding along the road, you hit a bit of gravel, deck the bike yourself, you know, whether somebody pulls out on you or whether somebody pulls out and you slam, put too much on the anchors or whatever, at some point you're going to hit the fucking deck. It was the first thing my dad taught me when I started riding motorcycles. First thing he said to me, the hardest part about learning to ride a motorcycle is the ground or the object that you hit. You know what I mean? And I mean, when you think about the way the roads are now, the amount of traffic we have now, back when I was started riding, the chances were a lot lower. Yeah. But nowadays, with the roads that we've got, with some of the road conditions, with potholes and shit like that, you know, it can be bloody fatal. It can be fatal. And I think it's something that everybody should think about, you know, because it is inevitable that at some point you're going to hit the deck. Guys, see, it's the other fools out there. Another thing which my dad said, you know, one thing you have to look out for when you ride on a bike, just remember that everybody else out there is a fucking idiot. You know what I mean? So I think I had a good teacher on that. Ross Cannon, I would like to have been in an MCC, but work rotation makes it hard. Yeah, well, this is why I totally agree with having social clubs and riding clubs, those types of clubs, because it allows people to be able to experience that side of the life and mix with people that are in that side of the life, yeah? And then maybe one day, if your job allows it, you know, you go maybe to a different job that allows you to be able to switch, then you've already got the contacts and everything there to be able to make that switch and do it a lot easier. Yes, potholes do suck. Absolutely. Yeah, you're dead right on that one, the hall. Yeah, if you ride in winter, it's inevitable you're going to hit the freaking deck. Do you know what I mean? Even with all the years I've been riding, you know, I mean, I was out riding my bike, just before I went out to Malta, when I went out and did that ride and I put it up on YouTube. I met up with a few of my mates after that, yeah, and we almost got caught up in something, you know, brakes locked up and the bike going, whee! You know, so it can still happen even to the best of us, even to the most experienced riders. What's that, Alan? I do road construction in NY. I fill in as many potholes as you see. Yeah, but the thing of it is, you see, it's, this filling in potholes is literally just a temporary fix. And you know as well as what I do, if you're in construction, yeah, and you fill in a pothole, you know yourself that once people start traveling over that and it starts breaking up that what you've put in there, that then creates an even fucking bigger hole. The only solution is to redo the whole road. You know what I mean? It's the only real solution. You know, it's fixing holes. It ends up being very expensive. And all you do is you just create a bigger problem later on. And it's usually within about 6 months, judging by the road outside my house. In the end, they got so fed up with coming along, filling the holes. They just went down. They got the machine and they scraped that fucker right back to the concrete. And they just did the whole thing. They just resurfaced the whole thing. They put a new fucking layer of tar on it. It was about 3 inches thick all the way down the road. And that's what they need to do. Stop all this pissing around filling up potholes. They just make bigger potholes and they start to break up again. I took your advice from when I first got my 125 4 years ago and built up experience on all weather and all situations before going to a bigger bike. Yeah, well, that's what I would suggest everyone does. Obviously, in different countries, they have different laws which allow them to jump on a Kamikaze 1 million as soon as they've been down to the testing center and rode around a few cones. There we go. You can ride whatever you like. I enjoy seeing those videos on YouTube. You know, these guys, they go and do this test. They go and buy this bike. They jump on a fucking great big, 1,000cc Harley. And the next thing you see, they're planting it into the side of a parked car at the side of the road. You know what I mean? It just cracks me up. That stuff does. Jazwell, smash my king to bits around here. Nearly threw it up the road the other day and lost a few teeth. Ooh, ouch. Ouch. Yes, you don't want to lose teeth. I lost a few teeth. This side in a big crash that I had, which was the one that nearly killed me. Got four missing up here from that one. So, yeah, I know how that feels. Some UK heroes started drawing big willies on the road to get the council to fill the potholes in. I remember seeing those. Someone started doing that round here too. That kind of incentive. The one I thought was really funny as well, the guy that was going around planting cannabis plants in them as well. Did you see that one? He was planting little cannabis plants in them, and then there was some other people going around putting fucking peat in them and putting little tiny miniature flower beds and that in them. Yeah, you've got to give the council some sort of incentive, haven't you? What and where's my favourite place in Scotland? I did the coastal road, so I didn't really sort of stop off anywhere. You know, the coastal road, you go, ooh, you go all the way around. I liked Belfast. I used to go out to Belfast and deliver cars for a company I worked for many moons ago. So I enjoyed Belfast, the nightlife up there, Not Belfast. That's in Ireland. Glasgow. Not Belfast. Belfast. That's where I'm hoping to go next. Glasgow. Glass, Belfast. Fucking, where was my brain then? Glasgow. Yeah, you got to love that Kamikaze 1 million, That's a good bike, Terry Marsh, are there bikers that like groups like The Jam, The Who, and The Kinks? And I love all that stuff. It's all part of my record collection. Music doesn't define you in regards to being a biker. Do you know what I mean? Hide them in tomato plants. You know it, Alan. Your first crash was with an off-duty rescue squad that never saw you from Grimvander. Yeah. I've had police cars pull out on me before. You'd think they'd know better, wouldn't you? Do you get to see proper skins out there? What do you mean, proper skins? Proper skin heads? I know, some fair few skinheads. That's where I started. I was a skinhead. But I wasn't one of these ones that go Zeke Carl and all this bollocks. Anti-racist me, mate. Question for you, what do you think of support clubs? I'm actually doing a whole video on that. I've had a fair few people contact me on that one, guys that are in support clubs. So I will be touching on that because they do serve a good purpose. And I'm going to be doing a whole video about it, probably within the next couple of weeks. Would you do meetups and then all go for a ride? Look, like I say, there's a lot of politics involved. So it's, I'd meet up with people that are not club related and go out for a ride with them. But then again, I like to know who I'm riding with. I like to know their habits and all this type of stuff. I won't just meet up with people I don't know and won't ride with people I don't know. I have to know their habits and everything. Hello there, VMAX Sam. Good to see you. Yeah, you know it, Alan R. You know it, mate. Sharp. Absolutely, mate. Sharp crew. Support your local dibber. Being a skinhead is about unity, most. Well, that's because it was hijacked, wasn't it? It was hijacked in the 1970s by a bunch of fuckheads that took the look because they thought it was an aggressive look. You know, and you know what makes me laugh about this, right, is because they don't even know where that look originated from. You know, they're all walking around doing their fucking Zeke Hiles and all the rest of it and, you know, totally against black people and all this sort of thing. And they don't even know where that look originates from. And I'll tell you where that originates from. That cropped hair, that's Afro-Caribbean, yeah? You know, the style of clothing, that comes from the old mods. Yeah, the docker boots and everything comes from the working class lads, yeah? The rolled up jeans, that comes from the Afro-Caribbean. Yeah, Fred Perry's and all this sort of stuff was all part of the mod scene. So it's a blend of two cultures. And it was created down in London. It's a blend of two cultures. And then they're walking around with this uniform on that's supposed to represent the blending of two cultures, and they want to rip the cultures apart. You know, it's kind of really ironic, isn't it, really, when you think about it. I laugh my tits off when I see them, and I make a big point of going up to them and say, you do know where that uniform that you're wearing comes from? And I make a point of educating them on it too, because I think they're a bunch of fuckwits. Do you know what I mean? Absolutely fuckwits. John Linden, how you doing, bud? I'm doing fine, thank you, geezer. I'm trying to scroll through these as quick as I can. The original skinhead was someone who liked ska. Ska originated from Jamaica. Absolutely, you're absolutely spot on. Absolutely spot on. I bought my first ska record back in the days when Bob Marley was, because obviously they started off doing barbershop music first, and then they went to ska music before they started doing the reggae stuff later on. I was 7 years old when I bought my first ska record. So, yeah, that's how long I've been into that stuff, and I'll be 55 in April. So I've been into this stuff for a long, long time. Depends of if it's original skins or mod. There's no such thing as a modern Nazi skin. It's a stolen fucking culture, mate. It's a stolen uniform. They stole it from the anti-racist guys, you know, that actually created that, which was a blend of working class lads, black Jamaican, Afro-Caribbean, and the mods from London. They created that, man. That was created in London. And it had nothing to do with racism and all that type of stuff. Nothing at all. Absolutely fucking nothing at all. Nothing. Oi, oi, oi! what's this one? I had a young skinhead assigned to my crew, was asking him questions and had him crying at the end of it at lunch. He went missing in action off the job. Alan, I know my shit when it comes to ska music, man. I spent many, 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 many moons down in Harlesden, mate, mixing with the old fucking proper ones, mate, the old originals and the old Rastafarians and all that. I used to go to the big dances and all the rest of it. I spent a lot of time in that. Might be a biker, yeah, but I'm one of the only bikers that used to turn up at skinhead events and reggae events and what have you, and two-tone events on my bike. Live Oi music, they got it from England football. Football. When am I going to ask you to name the next live stream? Well, we're up to 1 hour and 24. So I guess you guys can throw it out there now, because I always do these streams for 1.5 hours. So you've got 5 minutes now, but other people, I'm obviously going to be throwing up, answering a few more questions. Speaking of stolen uniforms, a lot of the Nazi skinhead stuff is just gimmick. There was openly gay, well-known skinhead named Nicky Crane, who was covered in Nazi tattoos, and he was gay. Well, there's gay people in every walk of life, mate, including the biker life. From South London, reggae ska was everywhere. We loved it. Yeah, it was. Right. Wish I lived in England. Right, so come on now. You can start putting up your suggestions for the title for this week's stream. Capo write, did I retire from the whole club thing because I was ill? Do I miss it? I still mix the clubs and everything. You never retire from it. I just had to step back from it all because I was too ill. I couldn't even get my bike off the fucking side stand. I was so weak. All the first round of chemo drugs. If people go back through my video archive, they can actually still see how ill I was at the time when I started making videos on this channel. I was really shit ill, I'm telling you. To the point I couldn't even fucking lift up a cup in the morning to, you know, I'd be there with a cup on the table with a straw. So, Nicky Crane was part of Screwdriver, yes. Next stream, Kurt Sutter or Cocksucker. Ooh, that one could get me in trouble with Google. I might do something like that, though. You never know. Putting the world in general to rights. The rabbit rises from the ashes. The rabbit rises from the ashes. Yeah, it could be because it kind of fits in with what we did last week. Want to say thank you, Dibs, for giving your time out and your wealth of knowledge. You know, all I want is to see people safe and do things the fucking right way. That's all I want. That's all I want from what I do on my videos and all the rest of it. I just want to see people doing things safely, yeah, and the right way. That's all I want. Only one thing wrong with being a biker. Is cars on the road. That would actually make a good title. So come on, guys and girls, you've got 3 minutes to get those titles in. I won't tell you which one I'm going to pick until I put it up. But if you make YouTube videos and I choose your title, make sure that you leave a comment, in the comment section so I know, where to go for your YouTube channel. Because last week, the person who picked it, there was four other YouTube channels that all did biker videos, and I had to go and contact him through to find out which one it was. Cunts in Cages. Orville is serving 17 years for oral sex for historical sex crimes. You're welcome, Guy. You're welcome. If you live in a rural area, cars aren't much of a problem. Absolutely right. I live in a country rural area, man. I know what you mean. Well, you only have to look at my riding videos. You can see I can go hooning through country lanes and not even see a car. You know, so it's, that's the only thing I'm going to miss if I move to Malta, because the roads out there can be really, really hectic. And the rural roads are a freaking nightmare. If you go across the Jester's Lab, man, and you check out his videos, you'll get to see all the different kind of road conditions you have to deal with over there. And some of them are really, really shit scary, man. Right. Okay, then. So the rabbit rises from the ashes so far. So come on, guys. Let's see what you can do. Let's see some more crazy titles going up there. We've got a couple minutes. I'll be doing the off-ski. So I'm not going to say anything now. I'm just going to sit back now for you guys to start throwing up some titles for this live stream. I want you guys to pick it. And if you make YouTube content and I use your title, leave a comment in the video comments and I'll come across your YouTube channel, because I want to make sure that I credit the right YouTube channel for it. But obviously, you have to make YouTube content, because there's no point in me sending people to an empty channel. Dibbing it up on Sunday. Yeah. Zombies are my rabbit. Project Redfoot. We're all part of the special squad. Yeah, you have to be special to come into one of my streams. No shitting in the urinals. That's what phone boxes are for. That's a good one, yeah. Oh, that's a shame, guy. You've got to get some fucking content up, man. Got to get some content up. The rabbit returns. Adam's life on two wheels. What's my favourite biker movie? Oh, I've got loads, but one of my all-time favourites is Stone. Project Reverse Rozzers. That's a good one. The Hool. Yeah, the Rozzers. None of us like Rozzers, do we? Right, let me just scroll back up here again. I just want to scroll up because someone actually donated to the stream. I want to give them a link or a shout. Oh, dear. If you was the one that made a donation to the stream, leave a comment on the end stream when it's finished, because I'd like to credit you in the description. The Mayans ate your baby. All Gatso must die. Absolutely agree with that one. Spinning the shit and burning the rubber. Well, what I'll do is I'm going to wait for the stream to finish. And then obviously it takes a little while for all the live stream to appear at the side of the video. I'll just leave it as live. And then what I'm going to do is I'll go through all the comments and I'll look up the YouTube channels and see who's made content. And then what I'll do is I don't know. Shove the dead rabbit up Sutter's ass. Shove the dead rabbit where the sun doesn't shine. I could do something like that, because obviously if I put ass in the title, I get Google coming down on my ass. Burn rubber, not your wallet. Spinning the shit and rubber. You see, the problem is if I put swear words in the title of the videos, Google come down on us for that stuff now with their political correctness bollocks. Yeah, they seem to be all right with you swearing like hell in a video like I do, but you put anything nasty, dodgy in a title or a description, they come down on you like a sack of shit. Yes, Alan, I'll try and do the same next Sunday. Only next Sunday I'm going to be sitting here with a few of these if the weather's good and I'm not taking any meds, mate. So it could get lively. Anyway, I'm going to do the off-ski, yeah? Google has absolutely ruined YouTube. Yes, I couldn't agree with you more. Anyway, I'll catch you all later. And I will catch you all another day, another way. Thank you all for tuning in. It's been a blast again. And yeah, if all goes well, I will see you all next Sunday. And if I have any more news on Malta, I'll put it up during the week. If you go to the main page of my YouTube channel, you can find links to my Dibber 39. I'm going to start uploading a load of comedic stuff over there. So those of you who think I'm just too damn serious, yeah, you might find some stuff that's a little bit more amusing over there with my twisted mind. Bob Hardnut, the Dark Lord of the Underworld. Yes, you got to meet that character. Dick Stroker, yeah. Bert the Angry Sock, and we'll catch you another day, another way. Peace out, peeps. 39 is great. Peace out.